Mat 31, welcome to section 4.2. We're going to be modeling with linear functions. And when we say modeling, that's a fancy word that we use in math and statistics to say we're going to take some data points and we're going to put, in this case, a linear function over them. And that linear function is going to be a model. And we're going to model our data based on a line and then usually predict a little bit into the future with it. And today we won't be predicting as much into the future as we will in section 4.3. When we get to the next section, we're still going to continue to build linear models from word problems, from verbal descriptions, but we're really going to use statistics in the next section. So this is the more math side of building linear models. And in section 4.3, we're going to introduce statistics to build linear models. So here's the how-to. Given a word problem that includes two pairs of input and output values, use the linear function to solve a problem. Okay, so I want you to hear in this box, you're gonna have two pairs of input and output values, which means you will be given two ordered pairs. All right, so we're going to go through many different examples in this section and in the next section. But for 4.2, there's a certain type of problem where you're given two ordered pairs in your word problem, and then these will be the steps to solve that word problem. And when we get to the next page, you'll be given one ordered pair and a slope. So sometimes you're given 2 points, sometimes you're given a point and a slope, and they have the same end game, but just slightly different ways of getting there. So if you're given two ordered pairs, identify those input and output values, convert the data into two coordinate pairs, find the slope between those 2 points, write your linear model. Again, linear model, this is fancy speak for let's go with mx plus b. That is a linear model. It's the equation of a line. And we'll eventually do quadratic models and logarithmic models and exponential models, but we're doing linear models right now. So once we get our model established, we will use that model to make a prediction by evaluating the function at a given x value. Or there will be times when we use that model to identify an x value that results from a given y value. And make sure you always answer the question that was posed to you. So I know that sounds like a lot, but how we're going to start these problems is we want to identify the two ordered pairs, the input and output. And in the previous section, you heard me say things like, you should ask yourself when you see a word problem, what are the variables, right? That's always a good question to ask yourself. Keeping in mind that if there's a time variable, it's probably the input variable. So once you figure out what the what the variables are, see if you can decipher what the x and y variables are. And then I was saying in 4.1, ask yourself, were you given ordered pairs? Or were you given a slope? Or maybe you were given one of each. For the problem we're about to do, we're going to be given two ordered pairs. All right, so with that, let's take a look at this problem. I'm going to scooch this up, and we're going to see how far we can get with this thing. All right. So let me move that up so I have all sorts of room to work through this. So as I read this, let's see if we can kind of keep track of what are the variables in this problem. All right, what is varying? Or we could say identify the input and output values. So a city's population has been growing linearly. In 2008, the population was 28,200. By 2012, the population was 36,800. Assume this trend continues. Predict the population in 2014 and identify the year in which the population will reach 54,000. All right, so let's take a step back and let's see if we can identify the variables here. What is varying in this problem? And one thing I can see varying is time. I see two time values. All right, so that's most likely going to be my x variable. All right, year. Now, based on what year it is, I can see that there's a city's population is growing. So my y variable here is the city's population. So So here's my X, here's my Y, and I heard two ordered pairs in here. I heard the ordered pair 2008 and then 28,200, as well as 2012, 36,800. So let me go ahead and write those down. So we've got 2008, 28,200, and we had 2012, and we had 36,800. All right, so I've got my two ordered pairs. I've converted that data to two coordinate points. The next thing I wanna do, if we go back up here and look at the how-to, I'm not gonna scooch it back up, you can read it. The next thing it says is to find the slope. So let's find the slope between these two points. We always have y2 minus y1 in ratio to x2 minus x1. All right, so y2 would be 36,800 minus 28,200. And then I would have on the denominator 2012 minus 2008. So if I run through this, it looks like we're dealing with, oops, let me grab my calculator. Oh, that was my calculator dropping. All right, so I'm gonna do, let me clear this out. I'm gonna do 36,800 minus 28,200. Looks like 8,600. And in that denominator, I have 4. All right. And before I go any further, just so that we can kind of feel this out, so we can interpret it, let's think about the units here. 8,600, what are the units on that? Again, is that 8,600 pieces of paper? Is that 8,600, I don't know, books on your shelf? No, the units for that are people. This town increased by about 8,600 people between the years 2008 and 2012. So this is 8,600 people, and this was over the span of 4 years. I want to simplify that. I want to actually see what the unit ratio is. So I'm going to do 8,600 divided by 4, and I get 2150. So this is really 2150, or I could write that as 2150 in ratio to 1, right? So this is people per year. So this town is growing on an average of 2,150 people per year. And I won't say that it's exactly 2150 per year. I don't know if 1 year was better than the other, but I know on average, over the course of the 4 years, it averaged out to about 2150 people per year. So let's just interpret that a little bit. So 2150 people per year. All right, and again, anytime you hear the word per, we're talking about a slope, some kind of rate of change. All right, so I've identified the slope. The next thing I need to do is get my linear model. Now, I have a slope and I have two points. So I could use the slope-intercept form of the line, but I'm gonna just use the point-slope form of a line. So to get my linear model, I'm gonna put a little separator here. All right, so I'm now working on step 4 of my how-to up here. So I would do y minus y sub 1 is equal to m times x minus x sub 1. So I would do y minus, now I could use either of these ordered pairs. And as I've said before, I like to use the one with smaller numbers. So I'm gonna do 28,200, and that would be equal to my slope of 2150 times x minus, and then we had 2008 here. And these are gonna be very large numbers. All right, I had talked in a previous section about using a Bézier. I'm gonna show you how you can use a Bézier after we do this with the really large numbers. I'm gonna show you why using a Bézier can just make your life a little bit easier. So here I would have y minus 28,200 would be equal to 2150x minus, and let's see what this gigantic number is gonna be. So 2150 times 2008, whew, all right, that is 4,317,200. And then I need to add this over. So ultimately I will have y is equal to 2150x. And let me take the negative of this answer and add 28,200. And if you weren't sure how I got this answer to show up, the reason I used answers is because I'm lazy and I didn't want to retype that. So you might have seen me hit my second key. Let me show you where it was headed. If you look over your negative symbol down here, you'll see the letters A and S. And that's how you can call up your previous answer. So I'm taking this answer and I'm gonna add 28,200 to it. So I'm left with negative 4,289,000. I think I need another zero. There we go. So that is just my linear model. I haven't even gotten to parts A and B, but this is MX plus B, right? I'm seeing my linear model. So with that, let's try and answer part A. And actually, before I do that, just because I'll answer part A, but I'm gonna write this up in function notation just so we can practice. All right, so let's write this as 2150T minus 4,289,000. You don't have to do that. I just felt like it because it's a crazy Saturday night here in the Abreu household. All right, so the first thing I see is predict the population in 2014. Well, 2114, is that an X value or a Y value? Well, you can see 2014 is a year, so I'd be plugging it in for X, or since I changed the letter, I'd be plugging it in for T. So I want F of 2014, and this would be 2150 times 2014 minus 4,289,000. All right, this will be a large number, and when we subtract it from this number, we might not have too large of a number left over. So let's see. I'm gonna do 2150 times 2014. And if I wanna subtract this number, I could also just add my answer. So it looks like I'm gonna have about 41,100 for my numerical answer. But keep in mind, this is a word problem. It should have some units on it. So I want you to think 41,100, is that an X value or is that a Y value? Well, this is F of 2014. So when you do F of something, that's the Y value. And the units on this, if we're talking about the city's population, this is 41,100 people. Okay? So this is what would be step 5 of this how-to, right? I use this model to make a prediction, right? I predicted the population given this X value, given the year 2014. So part B is asking us to go the other direction. It's asking us to do the how-to, or the step 6 of the how-to. This time they're saying identify the year in which the population will reach 54,000. So I want to find the year when the population is 54,000. Well, is 54,000 an X value or a Y value? It's a Y value. So this time I'm going to set F of T equal to 54,000 and see what year I get back out. All right, now I don't have to, but I'm gonna get some gut feelings. If in 2014 we were only at 41,000 people, I'm gonna guess that it's gonna take me a little bit longer to get all the way up to 54,000 people. I'm gaining about 2,100 a year. These are about 10,000, 13,000 apart. So I'm gonna say this is gonna take me like at least another 5 years. That would be my guess. So maybe 2019, 2020. But let's solve for T. If I add this over, I'm gonna get 2150T is equal to, let's see what, 4,289,000 plus 54,000 leaves me with. And I would get here, okay, 4,343,000. I'm going to divide that number by 2150. And it looks like the year is 2020. And the units on this are years, right? So I would say the population will reach 54,000 in the year 2020. I could also have said that in 2014, the population, or we're going to predict the population to be 41,100 people. Okay, so before we move away from this example, I do want you to see something where I use a base year. All right, I personally use the base year because these numbers are just too large. I find them very cumbersome. So when I say base year, All right, you can choose any base year you want. You can choose a base year of 1900, 1950, 2000, 2008, it doesn't matter. I'm going to just, for fun, if I chose my base year to be the year 2000, okay? That would reset and 2000 would be year zero, all right? And then what that would mean, right? So this would be year zero. So that means 2001 would be year one, right? 2002 would be year two. And really what I need to get to is 2008. Ooh, that doesn't look like an eight. 2008 would be year eight. And 2012 would be year 12. And these would be 8 and 12 respectively because they are 8 years after my base year of 2000. This was 12 years after my base year of 2000. Now, if that was the case, this ordered pair would be 8, 28,200, and this would be 12, 36,800. Right? These would be much smaller numbers, and it would make your life easier. So I'm gonna put up a different version of this problem, a different solution, with the base year of 2000. So I want you to see what this looks like if the base year is actually 2000. Okay, so if my base year is 2000, you see my ordered pair is 8, 28,200, and then 12, 36,800, and you can see I'm still gonna get the same slope. All right, but when I go to do the slope-intercept form of the line, my numbers are nicer because I don't have a 2008 here, I only have an 8. So I don't get that really large number, I'm forgetting what it was right now, 4,317,200, I just get 17,200, and I get a y-intercept here of 11,000. That is much nicer than the 4,289,000 we had. Now, you wanna be careful. If you use this base year of 2000 and you try and answer part A, you don't wanna plug 2014 into your function because your base year was 2000. Right? If you're going to plug 2014 in, this would imply that the year was 14 because everything's getting reset when 2000 becomes year zero. So when I plug 14 in, I get 41,100. And you also want to be careful when you do part B. When you solve this equation, you get 20. Well, it doesn't mean that in the year 20, we have 54,000 people. It means 20 years after my base year of 2000, I get 54,000 people living in that city. And so what I would say again is the population will reach 54,000 in the year 2020. It's just 20 years after my base year of 2000. So you'll see me as we start to go through these problems. Whenever we have time as our independent variable, I will be putting a base year in there. And you can pick your base year. It didn't have to be 2000. Sometimes I'll pick 2008. And just set this to year zero and then set this to year four. That gives me the smallest numbers to work with. All right, so that was an example of how to use a linear model. And just so we're clear, this thing right here is my linear model. How do we find our linear model and how do we use our linear model when we were given two ordered pairs? We're gonna do the next example. And instead of being given two ordered pairs and finding the slope, I'll actually just be given the slope with one ordered pair. So I won't have to do all of this shenanigans. All right, so with that, I'm gonna flip over to example two. I'll see you in a few, bye.